Hello David, welcome to World Cuisine. World Cuisine is the part of Private Kitchen in which we interview a media composer who is working on an international level, and we really want to know how this all came about. So first question would be, can you tell us a bit about your career, about all the projects that you've been doing and how things got so far until now?
Hi, Rens. Thanks for inviting me along. It's great. I started out working at the BBC, not in music though. So I music was never on my agenda to do as a career. And so I started out in broadcasting, and I was doing music for fun, and I was working in sound in TV. So I was looking for an opportunity of work at the BBC that I could do as a sort of ongoing thing, a career thing. Just by chance, somebody asked me to do some music for one of their shows. I thought that's perfect. That fits the bill perfectly for what I'd love to do, you know, because I love theme tunes anyway, and love the BBC, love working in the broadcasting. So I thought, great. So I came up with this idea for a theme tune. They said, yeah, we'll use it, you know. And so that started the ball rolling. And because there weren't that many people around doing what I was doing, you know, I was literally pretty much the only person in the building or around then that they knew that did what I did. Other people would come up and say, could you do one for me? Can you do one for me? So I built up this portfolio of work over 7 or 8 years, and then opportunities got bigger and other work came in. Then eventually we got this chance to do an advert for British Airways, and then that catapulted our career, or my career, into a different trajectory. I met a guy that had a record label, and then he said, do you want to make a record? And started making, you know, music for this record label. You know, I was making better music, I thought, than I was at the beginning. And also the production programs were getting more interesting and better, and, you know, from local TV up to network TV and sort of peak time TV. So it was a gradual build. And I never said no to any work that came along, you know, corporate work, from doing sort of like an army training video to sort of like a sex education video, and then all sorts of TV work, and the odd little bit of drama, which was great. I love doing drama, but really you have to be in a different place to do drama, I think. Starting from scratch, wanting to do that, and going to music college or conservatoire and studying, coming up through that area. So I did a full-length feature film, a low budget, but it was good fun. TV dramas and wildlife films and soundtracks for those. I just enjoyed doing theme tunes and focusing on more populist shows, you know, so that's where I was going. So yeah, it built up, and then I got to sort of late 90s, and then probably the peak, I'd say, of my career, where I had a hit single in the charts and got to number 3 in the UK, and it was a massive hit in Europe as well. And do you want a quick listen to that?
Yeah, shall we do that?
Okay, here we go. Have a listen to this.
Would you go to bed with me?
Hopefully you'll recognise that one. It still gets played on the radio now, which is great, you know. So, and then the year after that, I was asked to pitch for the BBC News theme, which I got. And so that was an amazing sort of like career thing for me. That was in 1999, and it's been on since then. And I'm still working on it as we speak, you know. So that's been amazing.
It sounds very interesting. Shall we have a look at the BBC News ident?
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so you're still updating it. So this is also kind of, it's becoming... It's there for how many years already now?
Well, it's been on for 21 years so far. The core sort of sound that we just heard pretty much hasn't really changed much. It's the same with, we've gone through sort of probably 4 or 5 refreshes of the core music, and the countdown, of course. That's become a sort of iconic thing in itself. There's the core music. There's lots of spin-off shows as well, especially for the 24 news channels, for World and BBC News. So there's always little bits of music to do for those as well. And so it's pretty much like having an ongoing contract, really. It's a bit like being an actor in a soap opera, you know, that's the really successful one. You know, it's like, it's pretty much my main job doing that now, you know, but I still love it, you know, and it's, I'm still so proud of having done that. The BBC for me was always a sort of exciting, curious, when I was a kid, you know, I was always enthralled and excited by it. You know, I had this idea of working for the BBC, so to create an icon that everybody recognises worldwide, you know, and you know that pretty much everybody's heard it, you know, Trump and, you know, Putin and the Queen and Prince Charles. And, you know, the chances are that at some point, pretty much everybody has heard it in the developed world, you know. And so that's a real sort of exciting thing. And it's also just to create an icon for the BBC, you know, that is long lasting.
Exactly, I think it's become part of British culture you've created.
Well, what's really great, I mean, yeah, it's almost a bit sort of surreal, you know, because here I am in my house in sort of in the middle of the country, and like nobody knows, you know, there's this thing beaming out around the world that millions of people know. And what's really great is like young, especially during lockdown, young people, you know, in their 20s and stuff, have started latching onto it, and they're going, oh, this is a real banging tune, you know, because it's sort of like a dance, it's a piece of dance music in a way, and it's got a 4-to-the-floor beat, which is the staple part of it, at 120 BPM, which is the time counting in seconds with the beeps on. And it gets played at clubs and things, and people have done their own remixes of it on TikTok, and a guy did one, a Dua Lipa sort of mashup, and she got in touch and said, oh, this is an amazing thing. So that got all over Twitter, and sort of for the marketing department of the BBC, love all that sort of stuff. So,
and at a certain moment in your career, you also started working on an international level. How did that come about? Were you looking yourself for jobs or projects internationally, or were you approached by people?
Fortunately, I mean, you know, I've been, touch wood as they say in the UK, I've been lucky enough to really throughout my career, I've never had to go out and sort of actively look for work. And of course, with every new piece of work, or like the BBC News, it increases the people knowing about it. And up until then, I hadn't done a lot of foreign work. I did one actually for the Mormons in the US. They got their own television channel, you know, and they said, oh, come over. And it was like a huge TV complex with studios and all that, and then we had this recording studio to ourselves, and it was great fun. But from the news, lots of other news networks from around the world got in touch, and the first ones were actually from India, NDTV. Sure enough, I went to New Delhi and stayed there for 3 weeks and had a fantastic time. We had took all my gear into his little office in this TV building in the middle of New Delhi, you know, with all the traffic outside, beep, 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 you know, and the heat, and, you know, we just sit there literally all day, and I was just making all this music, you know, because it wasn't just for the main news. It's, again, they have all these spin-off shows, like working with some of the local musicians as well was great. And which we'll talk about in a bit. But the other ones came really through a company called Lambie Nairn, which was the original, Martin Lambie Nairn, who sadly passed away, and he was a total legend. He's sort of done some of the most successful branding of TV in the 90s and 2000s. He did all the BBC branding and the news and Channel 4. He's been an inspiration there, working with him. For me, I learned a lot from him. So he originally commissioned me to do the news music. We've done Euro News in France, and we did a lot for the Middle East. We did Al Arabya was the first one. I got another one from a channel in Kurdistan, you know, which NRT, and you know, I did some music for them, and that was in between them getting sort of the building being literally was bombed by terrorists and stuff, and the head of the news channel was always sort of like under threat of being kidnapped and And, you know, that was how do they pay me? And it was a thing of going to one of those things where international travellers things where you go into a little shop in Oxford Street in London, you know, and give them a slip with a number on, and then the guy, you know, they sort of pay you in whatever, and so that was quite good fun. And then another chap from Lambinan moved to Hong Kong and married a lady from Hong Kong, and he set up his own branding company there, and aiming at Chinese TV, the CCTV, which is their main new state TV channel in China. Their main channel, CCTV 1, did all the idents for that, and then we've done a sort of drama channel, CCTV 9, CCTV 4, documentary channels, and that's been really good fun. Want it to be really nice, high end, and very arty and creative, and the pictures are always a joy to work with, and the designer Jason Keeley he's done a lot of them, and he's amazing on his designs, and really great to work with. So it's a pleasure to do those, and Norwegian TV as well. That was another one. Bloomberg Television in the States. So most of them have come from people knowing that I've done the news thing, rather than me having to go out and sort of tout for work, so, if you know what I mean.
So a lot of international productions, and so you are also confronted with a large different types of cultures, musical cultures.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Like I was saying earlier on, a lot of them like incorporating the sort of sound of the area or the regional culture, the instruments and the sound. For the Arabic ones in particular, you know, they wanted that to have a real Arabic sound, and they put me in touch with an Arabic guy over there. The Chinese ones as well, they wanted to have that flavour. So it's quite interesting, me sitting here, you know, in the middle of England, creating music for Chinese people. When the BBC do it, well, I've done it with the BBC quite a lot, and you don't want to be too patronising, you know, because it's like the BBC saying, this is African music, so put some marimbas in and stuff. They genuinely, you know, they like it, and the Chinese in particular love that flavour of having Chinese instruments in and the sound. I mainly research it a bit and just get a sort of overall feel of the sound, and then it's almost like doing an impression, you know, I'm going to do an impression of Chinese music, which probably gives it to them a different slant, you know, the detail you can only go so far with. And I remember once with the Chinese one, they said, oh, it sounds too Mongolian, and you know, what did I do to make it sound like that? But generally, everything I've done, you know, they've liked, and so it's been quite good fun actually doing that.
And I can imagine it's also easier when they fly you in, like in India, because then I suppose that you recorded Indian musicians over there, and so you have more the original stuff than.
Well, that was great. Yeah, I know. When we went, when I went over to India, we'd sort of got the template of the idea together. So we booked a studio in Delhi for a couple of days and just got all these fantastic musicians to come along and play. And just literally, I would get them to just improvise over loops and chords and things. We did have tabla. They had this tabla player that they used to use on all of their music. He was like a bit of a legend, and it was almost like a sort of tradition that he would be on their music, called Rafi. And so he came along. It was quite interesting though, because my music's pretty much quite solid, and all you really wanted him to do was go dung dak dak dung dak dak, but he would go. Well, if you'd ask him to say, Mark, can you just might try something different, just hit it with a stick or something? Oh no, you can't, you know, you're not allowed to do that. And the very set in to the tradition of it and how it should be. It was great because he invited us around for dinner to his house, which was a lovely experience. And that being a Muslim family, we turned up, and of course we weren't allowed to meet their wives, and we all sat on the floor. And then while we were waiting for dinner, they gave us this lovely little concert with his brother on sitar and him on tablas. His brother was sort of served all this going behind the curtain and bringing out all this lovely food, you know, like. And at the end, I just said, I've got to say thank you to your wives have cooked this food. And, you know, you're sort of almost part of the family. So they sort of came in and said hello, you know, and they'd all dressed up in their best clothes, you know, to cook the dinner, even though we weren't going to see them. So that was amazing, you know, the sort of tradition and the playing is all part of that.
Let's have a look at and listen to the ident.
This is NDTV, and you're watching NDTV 24/7.
So how did professional practice change throughout the years? Because you told me that you were asked by all people that were in your network. And is nowadays much more pitches going on also in your practice?
When I started, a friend of mine actually said, another composer, that he said when he started, it was like sitting in the middle of a lovely green meadow, you know, peacefully making music. And he said, now it's like sitting on a patch of turf in the middle of the motorway, you know, trying to do your thing. But around you, it's gone mad, you know. So it's sort of changed. And there's so many more layers of executive producers and more producers and more producers. And there's more layers of people pitching for music. And so got to push harder and out there and get, because there's more people obviously doing it. The technology explosion and the internet. Now they can use anybody anywhere in the world, you know. So it's definitely made it even more competitive than it used to be. And so everything now is pretty much pitching. Got two or three solid clients that will come back to me because they like to work with me and they know me and everything. It's just to have a really good relationship with the director and the producer is just the best way to work, you know, and evolving music rather than the pitching thing where they go mad and they pitch, ask 20 people to come up with an idea, you know, and it's just a bit crazy, really. I sort of still do the odd pitch every now and again. But yeah, it is. It's a completely different world than it. They take, obviously they take the publishing as well. And so if you're doing work for a TV company and then you just keep your 50% writer's share, they basically buy the whole rights off you, but they can't have that little bit. So you just get that independently anyway. Whereas when I started, you kept all your rights. Nobody even bothered to ask. In fact, people didn't really know what it was about. So that's changed as well, the business side of it.
Yeah, that's definitely changed. It's a recognizable thing also in the Netherlands, the whole right stuff. But financially, it's the whole BBC ident is a good thing for you, I assume.
Well, I mean, yeah, it's been a status, you know. For me, it's been amazing. You know, it's like a pension. You know, it's secured. Mm. It's pretty much secured my life for the rest of my life, really. So.
Thinking about the situation now in current practice, do you have any advice for younger people who want to start in this business, particularly in this whole business of television and commercials, the identity business?
The sort of gap between people wanting the music and needing it and then the people out there doing it. How do you connect with people that need the music? And it's always been the way, but it's becoming increasingly more difficult. So just keep doing it and sort of get to know as much about the industry as you can. Students coming out of music college and they've not really been taught about the business or the industry itself. They've been taught how to make a piece of music, but they haven't been taught about how TV works and how the industry works. Trying to get yourself a really good knowledge of the industry, you know, buy industry magazines, read what's going on, and because you need that asset as well as your ability to write the music, you need to know about the business, you know. Trying to find backdoor ways of meeting people, you know, sort of look at credit lists on shows and then say, oh, film editor so-and-so, contact him, you know, or whatever. But I suppose mainly the thing is just to keep doing it and doing it and doing it and get as much out there as you can on YouTube or whatever, as much music that demonstrates your ability to create music for TV and keep enjoying it as well, you know, find a way of making a living doing something else, you know, that so you're not having to rely on music as your thing and just enjoy doing the music. And so then you'll create better stuff, you know.
And try to develop, as you said, personal contacts, because that's still important in the end, of course.
Oh, I mean, that is the crucial number one thing, you know. Most of the people in the industry now, you know, are people that have been in it for years, like, you know, people are making the shows now have got to the top of the chain and they are making the shows, but it's taken them 20 years to get to that level, you know. And when you're coming in, you're starting out and you just don't go to that level straight away. You know, trying to get in touch with people that have been in the industry 20 years, know people in the industry 20 years, unless you're really amazing, you've done something incredible, focus on people in your contemporaries that are doing TV, you know, like people that have done television courses, or look around at people in other genres of the industry that are starting out as well and get to know them, because they'll be the ones that are sort of moving up the down the flow like you, you know. So
that's a good way, a good advice for younger people to do so. Invest in your own generation.
Absolutely.
Okay, I think we learned a lot from this discussion and meeting. I want to thank you for this meeting and Zoom meeting.
Great, I really enjoyed it.
And I wish you all the best.